Man, everybody knows you get hit in the head, you might get a concussion. But not everybody knows that 20 years, 40 years down the road, your brain gonna start to see the repercussions of your actions from a lifetime ago. This game ain't for the faint of heart, and I know one thing. You stay in this bitch long enough, it's lights out.
Cause sometimes you just feel tired.
Since the time of the ancient Greeks, combat sports such as boxing, wrestling, and submission-based competitions have held a significant place in human society. Presently, combat sports like boxing, Muay Thai, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, wrestling, and MMA are practiced around the globe. They represent a massive and growing industry with prominent MMA franchise UFC valued well over $2 billion. There are many controversial outlooks concerning the ethical nature of combat sports, with speculations that the politics of greed seem to supersede the health and safety of athletes. However, one issue within combat sports that is not controversial is that there is a high occurrence of significant and repetitive head trauma.
Till the lights go out, till my leg give out, can't shut my mouth, till the smoke clears out, and my high burn out, I'ma rip this shit, till my bone pull out, till the roof comes on, till the lights go out, till my leg give out, can't shut my mouth, till the smoke clears out, and my high burn out, I'ma rip this shit, till my bone pull out.
Music is like magic, there's a certain feeling you get when you reel and you speak, and people are feeling your shit. This is your
camera's on there.
Yeah.
Hope you have your good side showing.
Nope.
Alright, hide the drugs.
So,
you want me to look to you or look at the
camera? Oh, you can look at me. It's all good. Yeah, whatever feels natural. It's my first interview, so.
Okay. So, my name is Laurie Jesson. I am an athletic therapist at the University of Manitoba, and I'm currently the head athletic therapist with the Bison football team. I've been with the football team for the last 13 seasons, and I have seen a fair amount of concussions.
My name is Bryce Offenberger. I run Offenberger Muay Thai. I've been teaching and training Muay Thai for 17 years now.
Cool. So, my name is Doug Poulin. At this point, I'm 30, and I've been wrestling since I was in grade 10. I haven't stopped wrestling. Either I kept coaching, or I wrestled at UW in the inaugural season, so I've done collegiate combat sport as well. I have wrestled as an adult in any tournament that I can get my little hands on, so about 14 years now in combat sport.
Okay, my name is Dave Zeniga. I've been in combat sports for 28 years. Started back in the early 90s, competing amateur Muay Thai, amateur kickboxing, amateur boxing. Turned pro, I was about 19 years old. Competed at a professional level until I was 30. And then when I was 31, I opened up Nakamoy Gym. And it's now Dave's Nakamoy Gym. We're slowly getting into Dave's Gym Combat Arts. We're going to offer MMA, boxing as well. And we've been doing this for about 9 years now.
Right on. Hi there. My name's Nate Simon, and I'm currently at the University of Manitoba completing a bachelor's degree in kinesiology and athletic therapy. I'm also an amateur Muay Thai fighter with a record of 3-1. I put together this documentary to take an in-depth look at people's perspectives and opinions and knowledge surrounding concussion and CTE in combat sports. CTE stands for chronic traumatic encephalopathy, and it's a pathology associated with repetitive head trauma. We typically see it pop up in older athletes that were formerly in the NFL, that were boxers, or even ice hockey players. CTE is a tricky condition because of its delayed onset, as well as the fact that diagnoses can only be confirmed post-mortem. Making this documentary, I hope to shed some light on individuals' current knowledge, as well as things we can do in the future to combat this condition. Common themes emerge throughout this documentary that I believe will help us into the future of combat sports. All right, so hi, Jaren. Thanks for taking the time to chat with me. So I know you as a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu coach, but I know you do much more than that in the world of combat sports.
Yeah, sure. So I coach BJJ and wrestling, the grappling arts. I've also competed in kickboxing and MMA myself, and I've coached at a pretty high level, and I work as an official at a high level, both for organizations like Bellator or the UFC as refs and judge for both of them. And I've done that in Canada, in the US, in Brazil, China, Japan, Russia. You get the routine.
Chronic traumatic encephalopathy, CTE. It is a brain degenerative disease.
Even the stuff that we do know is just scraping the surface, so we need to really, really be really respectful of how much we don't know.
It is only diagnosed post-mortem.
Football players die from CTE and getting the after-death scans.
And as such, just to try to contain that ignorance. So when it comes down to any sort of injury to the brain and the tacit connection to the mind, I think we need to be more precocious than less.
Yeah, so for chronic traumatic encephalopathy for us in the industry, both as coaches and officials, is something in the sport of MMA that's top of mind.
Absolutely. If you're not training properly in the life, then absolutely getting kicked in the head or knee in the face or something like that can quickly lead to it. But I think it's more of a minority than a majority.
Right. It's definitely a risk out there.
I think anytime, especially when there are risk of head and neck traumas.
I think a lot of other sports downplay the risk that concussions are present, and as such, they contribute to a greater level of those injuries. I think headgear gives a false sense of security on a number of fronts. It does not prevent concussions at all.
A placebo, you think that you're okay because you have a headgear.
If you hit anything with enough force, you can cause that.
The spray paint can. And your brain is that ball inside, you shake it, you can coat that thing with a pillow, and if you're still shaking it, that brain is still going to hit against the edges. So
helmets are going to protect from other injuries like fractures, skull fractures, gloves are going to protect your hands, mouth guards are going to protect teeth injuries and mouth injuries, but not necessarily from concussion.
At the end of the day, it's how hard you're going, how hard you're training. Are you staying hydrated throughout the day that you're sparring, just in general?
No, I wasn't until I experienced it with one of my athletes.
I think everyone has heard of it, everyone knows of it, but I don't know that everyone is really that skilled or knowledgeable.
I'm not confident that they're doing everything that they can do for the safety of the individuals. And I know that kind of sounds extremely condescending, because well, I think I am or something like that. I'm not saying I'm doing a stellar job in any which way. I'm trying my best, absolutely. But I think the greater concern is that a lot of individuals just think that they're doing enough.
Informing and educating is really key. And like I said, at the pro level, I feel like we've done a lot of catch up. And I'm not saying we're at par, but close to par with the NFL. And as more information and more research is done, I think all the organization, all the major camps, coaches, officials, commissions, jurisdictions are all open to that. But I worry about that mid-tier and lower. When you go to your local yokel MMA gym where they have a promotion and a local fight with 1,000 people at it, 2 times a year, those guys are sparring all the same as professional fighters are and amateur fighters. And so I worry that there's no mitigating factor other than education. And I don't know that we have enough good soldiers spreading the good word, so to speak, around TBI and CTE. And then once we have enough of those, I think we'll start to garner a little bit of understanding.
In my opinion, combat sports is a little less of a health risk in CTE than it would be for, let's say, hockey or especially football.
So at the highest levels, it's certainly not any worse.
The training methods now compared to even when I was young, the heavier sparring isn't as frequent as it was back when I was younger.
I'm going to be honest, I'm not a big fan of the combat sports. I don't know that much about it either, but watching it, I find it very violent. I think both football and the combat sports have a high risk, just given the nature of the sport. Combat sports, again, just the direct blows that they receive, not necessarily just to the head. The mechanism of injury for a concussion can be a blow to the body that forces the neck into flexion extension.
In wrestling, we're taking preventative measures, so we don't let them suplex each other in Manitoba. One year, we got a big throw. He put him up in the air. He brought him down. He came down with his full weight, and the guy went to brace. And obviously, you see my arm, you know what happened.
It's clear from the literature that we still have a long way to go to get the sport to where it needs to be. When contemplating how we could make our sport that we love so much safer, a common theme emerged.
Education, education, education.
Personally, I have my certifications from the Coaching Association of Canada. So I know if I don't have my certification from that association, I cannot coach. So if they make that a requirement, every coach has to do it.
Anytime you can get multiple disciplines kind of coming together to create kind of a collaborative approach would be beneficial. It's going to be educational.
I think it's about mitigating the risk and making sure everyone's aware of what it is.
I would say do your research.
Be aware of all the risks. Understand where you want to fit into that kind of design. You know,
it's definitely a safe sport, and it's not going anywhere.
Enjoy. It's fun. It's tons of fun.
Well, I would say start today. Don't wait till tomorrow. What's amazing about combat sports, the barrier of entry is very limited. I appreciated the beauty and artistry of the sport and the fitness that comes with it, but also the mental game. You know, I really believe combat sports make a lot of folks better humans.
Straight punches hard from Nate Simon. Some hard punches from Achy Breaky, some hard knees. Almost a knee to the head. Simon comes back strong, ones and twos. And now attacking the body. And moving from the clinch and trying a body shot. And a headshot, and a headshot.
Oh, he's landing some good shots there, son.
Oh, good head movement, too, by Nate Simon. God, I love Muay Thai. So exciting. The punches are coming fast and furious, given the first two rounds were fairly close. Oh,
Simon's got great conditioning. He's not tired.
Great conditioning, moving in and out. He's almost like a fencer, as you can see. Oh, he's inside, he's out. Pinky wants to.
Yeah, he's really sharp with the hands here. He's countering.
Simon actually slid an elbow in there, too. You can see that. Oh, that's a great technique. Brett Hackey out first. It's going to be tough. He's going to have to do something here. Take him down. Get that round back. Oh, a couple of hard punches. Exciting, exciting fight.
Third round by unanimous decision. And in the blue corner, Nate Simon.
Taking his record to 4-0, sorry, 3-0, by Nate, the great Zoolander Simon.
In the blue corner, yeah!